family first is an expression you'll most likely hear in this part of the world. After all, Asians are known to be more collectivist compared to the West. But in the world of business, is blood thicker than water? Or do family-based Asian companies face a harder challenge to stay afloat? Joining us for an interesting discussion is Josephine Romero from the ASEAN Business Advisory Council. She is also the Go Negosyo Advisor for Angat Lahat Digital. Good to have you with us, ma'am.
Hi, good afternoon. Thank you for having me.
And according to sources cited by Forbes, around 70% of family-owned businesses globally do not survive the transition to the next generation. I wonder if this is also true for family-owned businesses here in the ASEAN region.
I would think so, yes. We get anecdotes from our friends in the DTI, the regional offices most especially, where they say, successful exporters who are serving international markets in the millions of dollars suddenly die because the children or the grandchildren do not want to pursue their grandparents' or mm-hmm. mother's businesses. Mm-hmm. So yes, it's quite common. And that's in the region. Now, if you look at the cities, there's a survival rate is a little higher, probably because family businesses here become more professionalized as they are educated or are exposed to more professional way of running businesses. But yes, those numbers are quite
accurate
yes.
And you have mentioned that there's that lack of interest among the next generations to pursue the businesses. But apart from that, what would you think are the other reasons that led to this instances?
Well, definitely generational gaps are a primary reason. But there's also that, there's this saying where people say you cannot choose your family.
Right.
So if there's friction among the family members in running a business, then there are more challenges because you cannot fire your child or you cannot fire your cousin or your brother or your sister. So we need to learn how to work with each other to make a success of our own enterprise as a family.
And independent parts of the board, I suppose, will also play an important role in family business.
Definitely. And there are quite successful Filipino and ASEAN based families who have learned to professionalize the way they run their businesses. Mm-hmm. In fact, there are some who are from rags to riches, started very small. But the grandparents had the vision to build their companies to last for a very, very long time. And they establish fundamentals that second, third, fourth generation families are able to keep.
How do you develop that interest among the next generation to continue the business?
I suppose there are many ways. One is respect for the differences among the generations. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, you immerse the entire family in the business. In Go Negosyo, one of the things that we do is to show role modeling. There's the big brother type of role modeling. There's also the mentorship kind of role modeling. The first mentor that we have as children would be really our parents and our grandparents. Mm-hmm. So if you immerse them not just in the culture of the family, but also in the culture of the business, then you get them to be part of the family from the get-go without having to force them. And then there's also the education. The younger generation get exposed to newer things, newer ways of doing things. And I mean, let's accept it. When they start living their own professional lives, what is today is chances are diametrically different from what it was 20, 30 years ago.
Right.
So allow them the diversity to practice their own interests.
All right. Innovation, I read, is also among the challenges in family enterprises because the global landscape is constantly evolving changing. Mm-hmm. How can this be addressed?
We have examples of young people who are third, fourth generation in their family and who are able to bridge between themselves, between their generation and the previous generation. How is that? They try to be as open as possible. no matter what the cultural differences are, they learn the new trends, mm-hmm. and then they see where they can weave this into the old family businesses, or they branch out, totally branch out, but without being confrontational about their own family business. So you cannot escape it. Like today, digitization is the way of the world.
Right.
So why fight it? Now, I'm seeing that seniors are actually very open to learning more about digitization. Nobody now wants to be, become obsolete.
Mm-hmm.
So I see in our nationwide and ASEAN-wide mentorship activities, those who are 60, 17, 80, they know what fourth industrial revolution is. They know what 21st century learning is. Mm-hmm. In fact, they espouse lifelong learning.
Right.
So I think that's key.
Now, considering these challenges, innovations you have mentioned, and then the interest among the next generation's transitions, how do you think does this affect the contribution of the of family enterprises in the Philippine economy? For example, from the past years, do we see an increase or a decline?
I would say that there has been an increase in the sense that you see more professionalization of families, especially in the urban centers. There is a professionalization of family businesses. You see family businesses who are actually listing in the bourse, in the stock exchanges, and not necessarily just the Philippine Stock Exchange. So what does that mean? It means that they are going beyond the family capital. They're opening themselves up to public capital. And if you're a public company, you will also want you will also need to open yourself to an external board of advisors mm-hmm. that will watch out what you're doing. So I think that's improvement.
And do we see this continuing in the future?
Well, we hope so. What we have found out, what we see nowadays is that there is just so much opportunity in the world today. Like here in the Philippines, they said that only about 400 families control the economy. Maybe even less. But no matter how small this number is, the opportunity is expanding. We are serving not just our neighborhood now, not just our country, not just the region. We're serving the globe.
Right.
So I think there's so much more to be had. So there's competition is best served with co-opetition.
You have mentioned opportunities. Is it more difficult to begin or grasp these opportunities, begin businesses with your family compared to other workers?
Only if you let culture or your friction get in the way. But with the availability of information now, I mean, the young generation are teaching their parents and grandparents to have immediate access to Google, like you mentioned, mm-hmm. or other information at their fingertips. Something that before they would go to the library or ask somebody to make a feasibility study for. Now, no. I mean, they can demonstrate in a matter of a few clicks mm-hmm. what they mean, or do a pilot, an immediate demo of what they mean, rather than wait a year or two for them to prove what they mean. So technology has caught up. And it has made it also easier for us to understand each other.
Now, businessmen in family enterprises, will they learn more about this in your upcoming event?
Most definitely. What we have designed the conference to be such that the top concerns of a family business will be addressed. When you say family business, the first thing that comes to mind is succession planning. Will my child, will my grandson, will my granddaughter want to continue with this business mm-hmm. if I make it so big? And then will it go to family or will it just go to strangers? So succession planning is one of the key points that we will be discussing. And then you mentioned the innovation,
yes.
Transformation. Mm-hmm. That is key. So we also put together a distinguished panel of speakers from ASEAN and from the Philippines to talk about examples of transformation case studies where third, fourth generation, or even second generation have tried to succeed. And then finally, we have put together a panel that will you know, show us examples how people manage their friction, mm-hmm. how they manage to professionalize themselves, and then eventually make their companies something that is built to last.
Right. This is the first time that the ASEAN Business Advisory Council will be holding such a conference. How can interested entrepreneurs participate?
We are online. Registration is online. Just go to Facebook, you'll actually see it. Just Google it. But it's Family Business Conference. At the same time, we do accept walk-ins. We're happily double the size we envisioned this conference to be. So there are about 750 people already registered to come. But since we're in a hotel, I think we still have room to expand.
I understand, ma'am, that this conference is part of your mentorship, the ASEAN BACS mentorship effort. And last July, I remember President Duterte asking the ASEAN Business Advisory Council to help in improving the skills of the workforce. How mm-hmm. is the ASEAN BAC responding to that?
Well, we have been doing this heavily since 2017, in fact, when the Philippines was a chair of ASEAN. ASEAN Business Advisory Council then elevated the Philippine Mentorship Program of Go Negosyo to a regional level. We call that the AMEN program, ASEAN mm-hmm. Mentorship for Entrepreneurs Network. This would be in line with mentoring the micro and small medium enterprises. Besides teaching them entrepreneurship skills, we need to teach them the culture of working together as families.
Right.